last Sunday after Pentecost is taken from the Epistle of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brethren, we have been praying for you unceasingly, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. May you walk worthily of God and please Him in all things, bearing fruit in every good work and growing in the knowledge of God. May you be completely strengthened through His glorious power unto perfect patience and long-suffering, joyfully rendering thanks to God the Father, who has made us worthy to share the lot of the saints in lot. And light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have our redemption through His blood, the remission of sins, and the Holy Gospel. I suggest that each one this morning read together with me, or at least listen to me, and follow along in the bulletin as we read today's gospel. Which is taken from St. Matthew. Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation, which is spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place, let him who reads understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let him who is on the housetop not go to take anything from the house. And let him who is in the field not turn back to take his cloak. But woe to those who are with child, or have infants at the breast in those days. But pray that your flight may not be in the winter or on the Sabbath, for then there will be great tribulation, which has not been from the beginning of the world until now, nor will be. And unless those days had been shortened, no living creature would be saved. But for the sake of the elect, those days will be shortened. Then if anyone say to you, behold, here is the Christ, or there he is, do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will arise, and will show great signs and wonders, so as to lead astray, if possible, even the elect. Behold, I have told it to you beforehand. If therefore they say to you, behold, he is in the desert, do not go forth. Behold, he is in the inner chambers, do not believe it. For as lightning comes forth from the east and shines even to the west, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Wherever the body is, there will the eagles be gathered together. But immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give her light. And the stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven will be shaken. And then will appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then will all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming upon the clouds of heaven with great power and majesty. And he will send forth his angels with a trumpet, and a great sound, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. Now from the fig tree learn this parable. when its branch is now tender and the leaves break forth, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see all these things, know that it is near, even at the door. Amen, I say to you, this generation will not pass away till all these things have been accomplished. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Thus for this Sunday's Holy Gospel. My beloved people, this morning I fear that I shall have to restrict myself almost entirely to the bulletin, for there are many things that I have to bring to your attention today. Today is, first of all, as I said earlier, the last Sunday after Pentecost. This year there were 25 Sundays after Pentecost. The normal number is 24. But since, because of the way Easter moves back and forth, what Sundays come after the Feast of the Epiphany at the beginning of the year, whatever Sundays are left out because of Easter, they have to be picked up at the end of the year. So this year we had to pick up one Sunday, which made it the 25 Sundays, but today is the last Sunday. It is also today the feast, the great feast of the Presentation of our Blessed Mother. And on this feast, on this occasion, we renew and receive oblates, the vows of the oblates, the promises of the oblates, and also receive oblates, which we shall do this morning after this Mass is over. The oblates are those who are about to enter into becoming oblates. Please congregate, let's say, in these front pews over on this side of the church after Mass. Everyone else is free to stay or to leave, whatever your schedule tells you to do. If you're free, you're perfectly welcome to stay. If you're not free, you have to go. So don't worry. Do what has to be done. Today is the last Sunday of the year, the liturgical year. And next Sunday, we begin the holy season of Advent. As everybody knows, perhaps newcomers or visitors, we have stressed the use of the home chapels, the monastic home chapels, the monastic home altars. And this is a time of the year, of course, our bulletins, the last several bulletins, as everyone knows, have concentrated, focused attention on the home chapels that we strongly encourage for ourselves. And as you also know, that there are those, heaven knows where, that you might wish to send copies of our bulletin to start the practice of home chapels. In these dreadful times, when Mass is not available, our church is not available for people, then the best we've got is to turn our attention to that which is in our own home. And I need not go into that this morning, because you know already the atmosphere that we are strongly asking for everybody's benefit. And in so doing, there's one thing that has to be stressed. We are not essentially, we are not promoting the home chapels as an end in themselves. They are a means to an end. And that is, my beloved people, our holy faith. Thy faith must be maintained no matter. So let us keep that in mind as we proceed. Thursday of this week is Thanksgiving. And may I take this opportunity to wish each and every one of you a very beautiful, a very holy, and a very delightful day of giving thanks to Almighty God. We will have masses in this church on Thursday at 6 o'clock and at 8 o'clock in the morning. Now, it has always been the custom, ever since I can remember, and even then it was an established custom, that the Friday after Thanksgiving Day is not, I repeat, is not a day of abstinence. And meat may be eaten on that Friday. Of course, the purpose of that regulation is for practical reasons. But some people, if I'm not careful, I haven't stressed this in the past, and there are those who got the erroneous idea that the only meat that could be eaten on that Friday was the meat that was cooked for Thursday. So you eat whatever meat you want on Friday after Thanksgiving. It is not a day of abstinence at all. So be perfectly free to eat meat on that day. And but it is a day that we must give thanks to Almighty God. It does have strong, very strong religious connections, and it is not just a civic affair, though it has turned into that into the minds of many people. It is a religious affair. And we should. We have everyone in this room has reason and strong reason to be thankful on that day. Let us make it a point. Let us make it an absolute point to say thank you, to speak thank you to Almighty God. And not stop just with the two words, but let us show gratitude. Let us show thank you to our blessed Lord, who is indeed good to us. During Advent, I ask that all of us pray for vocations to our monastery and to our convent. Now, attached to today's bulletin, again, are the Advent readings assigned for each day for the season of Advent, beginning with Sunday, next Sunday, and ending on Christmas Day, Christmas Eve. I know this is not easy. I know that our comings and goings and so forth and so on in our family circle make sitting together at any one given time to eat our meal, our principal meal, is not always possible, and it is sometimes quite difficult. But let us work to see if we can't institute that where the whole family gathers together to eat the meal at the same time. It's family that we're after. Family, if you want to cure the ills of the nation, if you want to cure the ills of the world, then we have to start with the family. And that's where it begins, in the family. And we suggested in these Advent readings that they be read aloud at the main meal by the head of the family, by the father, if he's there. If he's not there, by the mother. And if it should happen that either of these are missing, then whoever else is in charge. And when you read them, let it be a proclamation, not just a mumbo jumbo of whatever is on the book, on the printed page, but let us read these readings intelligently for the sake, our own sakes, and for the sakes of our beloved children. Remember what I have said before. We have to be serious people with serious intention, giving serious worship to a serious God. And there is no other way to say it. All of us, nobody on this earth is excused from this. Some have wandered away from it and consider themselves excused, but they're not. This is an obligation not put upon each other by man's voice, but by the voice of Almighty God Himself alone. You must love your Lord, your God. That's the first commandment, isn't it? So, the Advent readings. We strongly also encourage the use of the Advent wreath. We did not put ours up yet this year. Perhaps we should have, so that for those who might need to look for a model. But the Advent wreath, it doesn't have to be sophisticated, doesn't have to be enormous, doesn't have to take up the whole table. In the center of the table, your four candles. It is not just an empty ceremony. It is not just a Christmassy thing to do. It is an act of worship, and it is an act of expectation. During these 4 weeks of Advent, they are 4 weeks in which we go back to Scripture, and we pick up from Scripture the expectation of the coming of the Redeemer. And each Sunday, each week, we go into this spirit of expectation, awaiting. The Advent wreath is that. And it should bring and keep to our minds that which we are waiting for, that whom we are waiting for. These little purple leaflets here in the back, in the vestibule of the church, we strongly recommend that each one of you pick at least one of these up. Use them up. And if we have to have more, we'll have more here next week. But at least start off with one per family. To the entire, all of the ceremonies are in here for the 4 weeks. So, and the description of the Advent wreath is here. Now, what is Advent? Advent is not Lent. It has a quality of Lent about it, but it is not Lent. It is not as serious as Lent. So let us speak only in terms of Advent. And as we have so often mentioned, that in this life, there is so much to be accounted for, so much sin, so much evil, so much bad. And in our own lives, as I said, I think it was last Sunday, in our own lives, which one of us can pick up the first stone to throw it? Which means, in effect, that we ourselves have much to answer for. Who in this room is free from sin? Therefore, my beloved people, during Advent, we need to do a little something about it. Over here, you have the little the usual packages of wheat. Little packages here. This wheat has been blessed, specially blessed. During Advent, every time you find yourselves correcting a fault, every time if you are given to gossip, every time you find yourself about to engage in gossip, you tell yourself, no, I will not do it. And then go and get one little grain of this wheat and plant it. Now you say, how's that going to be done? My suggestion, and I think all of you know, any shallow container is fine. But perhaps the best that you all know, you know those little aluminum baking pans that you buy at the store? They're about so deep. They're different sizes. But get the one about a foot square, perhaps, and put just plain soil in it. Keep it in the house. And each time a little act of reparation, a little extra prayer, a little act of mortification, a little act of self-restraint, a little act of charity, a little act of just plain goodness, take one grain of wheat and plant it at that time. When Christmas comes and we go to our cribs in our houses, in our homes, each one will pick up his offering, pick up his little pan. It's a simple little thing. And for those who have no faith, it's a foolish thing. But for those who do have faith, it's a very holy thing. And we are bringing our gift. We're bringing our gift to the baby Jesus, our little pan that has the various ages of the wheat, the little grasses, the little sprouts of wheat, our gift to the baby Jesus, our gift of having kept our mouths closed when they should have stayed closed, that we have spoken truth when we should have spoken truth as always, and so on. Now, this is not just something for the little children, though the little children certainly should be encouraged to follow this little custom. And I speak only at this moment to the men. I always like to speak to the big, big, strong, strapping men who fear no evil and go through life with the strength of a bear. Men, it will take more strength on your part to pick up one little grain of this wheat. And go to your little container and plant it. It will take more strength on your part to do that tiny little thing, more courage on your part to do that insignificant little act than it would be for you to go outside and fight a battle and win it. That little impure thought that I put aside and stopped it before it became gotten control of me, a grain of wheat. That act of hatred that I stopped a grain of wheat. That moment of anger that I brought under control, a grain of wheat. And it goes on and on, my beloved people. That is living the Christian life. As I'm sure, as in the bottom of the bulletin today, it says our home must be a humble copy of the house of Nazareth. In our home, father and mother and children together must strive to raise Christian living in our day to its highest and noblest expression. Serious people with serious intention giving serious worship to a serious God. Help yourselves to the little packages of wheat. Maybe a package per member of the family. If we run out, there again next week, we'll have more. We have work to do, my beloved people. Lots and lots and lots of work. And our work has to be centered only in Jesus Christ. Again, I ask you to please kneel.